Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. It's Developing Your Troubleshooting Skills. It's part one of a two-part series. This is Making the Most of Your ICP-MS. So before we get started, I'd like to go over a few items so that you know how to participate in today's event. For the attendees unfamiliar with GoToWebinar, we've taken screenshots of the attendee interface. There are two ways in which you may have entered the webinar, either by downloading the application or by using the web interface. So on the right side is the web interface panel here, and then on the left side is your desktop version. The desktop application is shown here. On to the left is the viewer, which you can view the presentation. You can maximize this to more easily view what is being presented. On the right is the control panel, where you can ask questions and select audio mode, also download some handouts. Note that the control panel will collapse automatically when not in use. To keep it open, you can click the view menu and uncheck auto hide control panel. Here's the web interface. The presentation will be shown in your browser window, and you'll have web-based control panel to the right side of your browser. This is where you can ask questions, open handouts, or select the full screen mode. For the desktop application, you should see something that looks like this on your desktop in the upper right corner. It's the control panel. You're listening in using your computer speaker by default. And here you can choose your preferred speaker from the dropdown. If you would prefer to join over phone, just select telephone in the audio pane and the dial-in information will be displayed. You will have the opportunity to submit text questions to today's presenter by typing your questions into the questions pane of the control panel. The web interface is shown on the left and the desktop application on the right. You may send in your questions at any time during the presentation. We will collect these and then address them during the Q&A session at the end of today's presentation. So to hide and open the control panel for the desktop, just click the orange button with the white arrow that can hide it. And now I'd like to introduce our speaker, Ruth Wolf. So our speaker, Ruth Wolf, has over 20 years experience working as an analytical chemist in a variety of fields, including environmental and geochemical analysis, analytical methods development, instrumentation development, and technical sales and marketing. She returned to PerkinElmer as a field application scientist, senior field application scientist in 2016 after spending 12 years at the US Geological Survey as a research chemist. She has a PhD in chemistry from Colorado State University and an MBA from the University of Connecticut. There's her contact information. Her email is there. So now I'd like to hand it over to Ruth. Yeah, so please, as we go, and put your questions and we'll get to them at the end of the webinar.
Thank you for the introduction. Hello, my name is Ruth Wolf, and I'm a Principal Field Application Scientist with PerkinElmer. Welcome to our webinar on developing troubleshooting skills for ICP-MS. In today's webinar, we're going to first review the processes in ICP-MS analysis. Then we'll step through the system hardware so that you can understand where problems are likely to occur, what items to pay attention to, and some maintenance and corrective actions you can take to get the best out of your ICP-MS. The next section, we're going to look at common interferences in ICP-MS, what they are, and how to recognize them. And in the final section, we're going to discuss how to use raw data to troubleshoot your analytical problems, specifically understanding the importance of your blanks and your calibration type, and why looking at replicate RSDs are important. So let's review what happens in a typical sample analysis by ICP-MS. First of all, the sample is picked up by your autosampler. The peristaltic pump and the tubing delivers the liquid sample to the nebulizer. The nebulizer then forms an aerosol, which is conditioned by the spray chamber. That conditioned aerosol is then further desolvated and vaporized in the plasma, where the atoms are ionized and excited in the plasma, and then ultimately measured by the spectrometer. And finally, what we're all looking for, your sample results are then printed or exported. It all seems pretty simple, really. So that all seemed pretty simple, right? So what could go wrong? The answer is a lot of things. One thing to remember is that 95% or more of all issues in ICP-MS are sample introduction related. By sample introduction, I mean either the peristaltic pump, the nebulizer, and/or the spray chamber. For the peristaltic pump, your pump tubing could be old or worn out or improperly tensioned, or you could be using the wrong pump tubing. You could have a clogged or partially clogged nebulizer. The spray chamber might not be draining correctly. In some extreme cases, the spray chamber can fill up and the torch goes out. This can be caused by the pump going in the wrong direction or having your tubing hooked up backwards. Other things that can occur are leaks or air bubbles in lines causing signal spikes, or having too little or too much sample in the ICP. And finally, having your sample uptake, read delay times, and more importantly, your wash times incorrect can all cause all kinds of issues. Before we dive into the various parts of your ICP-MS, I want to talk very briefly about what needs to happen before the sample gets to your peristaltic pump, and that is sample preparation. This is a large topic, and we don't have a lot of time today to go into the details, but please remember these key points and resources. First of all, the standard sample introduction system in an ICP-MS requires a liquid sample. If you see particles in your sample, you need to either filter it, decant it, or digest it. For aqueous samples, typically we need to dilute them and/or acidify them. When you're doing this, don't forget chemical compatibility and stability. Silver is one of the problem elements in ICP-MS, and we have a lot of issues with not having enough hydrochloric acid and forming the insoluble silver chloride precipitate, which causes all kinds of issues for many users of ICP-MS. One thing you can do is pay attention to the labels on your stock solutions and what acid matrix they are in. There are many elements, such as the refractory elements listed on the slide here, that are not stable without some hydrofluoric acid present. And also please remember that stability can vary, and it's based on concentration, matrix, vessel, and also time. If you need some resources to learn more about liquid sample introduction in ICP spectrometry, this book is an excellent resource. If you have a solid sample, you're going to have to either dissolve or digest that sample before you can put it in your ICP-MS. When you're developing your digestion methods, you need to consider the homogeneity and the sample size digested to make sure that you get a representative sample. You also need to pay attention to the solubility and stability of the elements in your sample, and also consider the matrix and any hard-to-digest components. If after your digestion you have particulates left, that means that you have an incomplete digestion, and that could impact the accuracy of your determined values. There are also some sample preparation methods, such as the ones used for EPA method 3050-200.8, which are actually not complete digestion methods. These types of methods are actually leaches and will leave a lot of insoluble material after the digestion is complete. This will require you to generally filter the sample before you can introduce it into your ICP-MS, or you risk clogging your sample introduction system. One resource to get more information about elemental stability and some simple digestion methods for some types of samples is the Technical Center on the Inorganic Ventures webpage. This is an excellent resource to start to learn more about chemical stability of the various elements. So let's just take a minute to review what happens in the ICP-MS. First, the ICP, which stands for inductively coupled plasma, generates a high temperature, high energy plasma out of the argon gas applied to it. An RF field is applied to the load coil or the plates. This induces an oscillating AC current between the plates and causes electromagnetic fields at the top of the torch to remove electrons from the argon gas, ionizing it. This is what forms the ionized plasma discharge that we call the ICP. The ICP has a temperature of about 10,000 degrees centigrade and will ionize most elements. There are also molecular species created in the plasma via gas phase chemical reactions between the plasma gas and the elements in your sample, mostly coming from the sample matrix, which is predominantly water, so that we see neutral species such as hydrogen, oxygen, NO, CO, CO2, and other species being formed. The interface cones are a critical part of the ICP-MS, and the primary purpose is to reduce the pressure from atmospheric in the ICP, which is at 760 torr, to a high vacuum region, or 10 to the minus 6 torr, and they sample the stream of ions coming from the ICP torch and partially focus this beam of ions, maintaining its electrical integrity. The third cone, the hyperskimmer, used in the Nexian series of ICP-MS, further focuses the ion beam and reduces the amount of neutral species and gas loading going into the mass spectrometer. In the Nexian ICP-MS, the quadrupole ion deflector and the voltages applied to it turn the ion beam containing any charged ions 90 degrees while the uncharged species are extracted into the roughing pump. The QID voltages are adjusted to maximize ion transmission across the mass range into the universal cell, where interferences may be removed using either a collision or a reaction gas. This leaves the analyte ions to travel into the analyzer quadrupole. The analyzer quadrupole is scanned to allow the ions of interest to pass through to the detector one mass at a time. It is essential to realize that the quadrupole only lets one mass through at a given point in time, and a quadrupole mass spectrometer is essentially a sequential device. However, the scanning speed of the Nexian quadrupole is extremely fast and capable of scanning over 5,000 AMU a second. The ions of each mass hit the discrete dynode detector, where they are counted by being converted into an electrical signal. It is important to know that the detector just counts or sees the positively charged ions. It doesn't know that the ions are from any particular element. So if you see that you have just one or a few elements acting strange, you need to look upstream in the instrument to the chemistry of the element in question or the sample introduction system to find the cause. So let's step through the various parts of the ICP-MS system. The first step in any analysis is getting the sample into the plasma. One critical part in this is the peristaltic pump, which is used to deliver a constant flow of sample to the plasma. If your pump is not delivering a constant flow, then you will have a problem. Maintaining the pump tubing is critical. It is a consumable. Please keep in mind that the typical lifetime of a piece of tubing is 8 to 12 hours of continuous operation. If you notice that it is flattened, or you can't even remember the last time you changed the pump tubing, then you should change it. Worn tubing will affect the precision or reproducibility of your results because the pump is not able to deliver a constant flow. You also must adjust the tension of the tubing until you just see a steady flow. Do not over-tighten the tensioning arms, or this will lead to imprecision and premature wear of your tubing. Also, knowing which peristaltic pump you have is important. There are two types of pump used on the Nexian 1000-2000 systems. Both are mini pumps. The PerkinElmer mini pump shown in the upper right has a longer bridge distance than the ESI mini pump used on some systems. If you use the wrong pump tubing for the pump, you will not be tensioning the tubing correctly, and this will lead to incorrect flow rates and premature tubing wear. The part numbers for the PerkinElmer pump will start with an N815 number, while the part number for the ESI pump will start with an N814 number. If you were buying your tubing from a third-party supplier, you should check that the bridge distance between the two stops is correct for the pump that you have. Otherwise, you will be delivering an improper amount of solution to your nebulizer. The purpose of the nebulizer is to convert your liquid sample into a fine aerosol by mixing it with the nebulizer gas. There are many types of nebulizers available, and they are specialized for different applications and can vary in their efficiency, their sample flow rates used, and sample compatibility. Depending on the model of your system, the nebulizers supplied with your Nexeon ICP-MS include the Meinhardt and the ESI PFA. Other types of nebulizers can be used, and the few slides following will go into more detail. Nebulizers are devices that convert a liquid into an aerosol that can be transported to the plasma. The nebulization process is one of the most critical steps in ICP-MS. The ideal sample introduction system would be one that delivers all of the sample to the plasma in a form that the plasma can reproducibly desolvate, vaporize, atomize, ionize, and excite. If these processes are not reproducible, your analytical signal and your results will not be reproducible either. Because only small droplets are useful in the ICP, the ability to produce small droplets for a wide variety of samples largely determines the utility of a nebulizer for ICP-MS. The production of droplets with diameters of about 10 microns or smaller is desired, since these are the ones separated by the spray chamber and carried to the plasma. With typical nebulizers, this droplet range constitutes only about 1 to 5% of the total sample that is introduced into the nebulizer. This is often referred to as the nebulizer efficiency. The remaining 95 to 99% of the sample is drained into the waste container. One thing to remember is that the plasma only has about 12 milliseconds to complete all of the processes that ultimately produce the ions that are measured by the ICP-MS. If anything changes that changes the amount of time or completeness of these processes, like a change in the aerosol droplet size or the rate of desolvation in the plasma, this will cause fluctuations in your analytical signal and in your results. No single nebulizer does everything well. Different nebulizers may be more suited to a particular application or more desirable due to their robustness and ease of use or maintenance, as we will see in the next slide. You should select a nebulizer that is suited to your sample type or your application. You need to consider things like the ability of the nebulizer to tolerate the total dissolved solids of your sample and the sample matrix. Nebulizers that are easily plugged or broken may not be suitable for some environments. For example, a university teaching lab with multiple types of samples and users might be a place where you'd want a more robust type nebulizer. In general, concentric nebulizers produce a fine, reproducible aerosol, but they are less tolerant to particles in samples and may plug if care is not taken during sample preparation. Parallel path nebulizers are more resistant to clogging and can handle higher TDS levels, but keep in mind that generally for ICP-MS, it is recommended to keep the total dissolved solid levels below 0.2%, or you will also be plugging the orifices in your sampling cones, as well as the nebulizer. Glass and quartz nebulizers are good general purpose nebulizers, but they can be damaged or broken and cannot be used with hydrofluoric acid. Plastic nebulizers are generally more robust in terms of accidental breakage and also perform very well for ICP-MS. Please remember that instrument sensitivity will vary with the nebulizer type and the sample flow rate, and each nebulizer may need to be optimized differently to achieve the best performance. And finally, remember that most modern ICP-MS instruments use much less sample, with sample flow rates generally in the 100 to 250 microliter per minute range for sample uptake, and providing more sample to the plasma does not always mean more signal. In fact, providing too much sample to the plasma will cool the plasma and lead to higher oxides and matrix interferences. I put together the chart on the bottom of this slide of the most commonly used nebulizers in ICP-MS, just to give you an idea of the general characteristics of each one. However, you need to select an appropriate nebulizer compatible with your particular solution matrix and acid type or content, your sensitivity requirements, your tolerance to TDS or total dissolved solids, and your robustness requirements. One critical troubleshooting skill to develop is how to test your nebulizer to see if it is working properly. All concentric nebulizers should self-aspirate or produce an aerosol by pulling liquid into the sample line without pumping, with the nebulizer gas turned on. A concentric nebulizer is a nebulizer that has two concentric capillaries. The inner capillary is where the sample comes through, and the outer capillary is where the argon gas comes through to form the aerosol. If your concentric nebulizer does not self-aspirate, you should suspect it is plugged. If your nebulizer is not performing well, your results will suffer and you will have high RSDs and signal instability over time. To test your nebulizer operation, what you want to do is remove your nebulizer from the spray chamber and turn on the gas flow manually. In the Syngistics software, if you go to the main Syngistics menu, go down to System Tools and select the Nebulizer and Torch Gas Test, this will turn on the nebulizer gas flow. Then you can put the sample line into a container of DI water and see if your nebulizer will self-aspirate. If you hold the nebulizer up to a black background, you should see a very fine mist coming out of the nebulizer. If you see large particles coming out of the nebulizer, or it's spitting, or you see the mist is actually pulsing or off to one side, then your nebulizer is plugged and you need to perform some nebulizer maintenance. In terms of nebulizer maintenance, the best approach is to actually prevent your nebulizer from getting clogged in the first place. The simplest thing to do here is to make sure that you rinse it with a clean acid blank solution after the last sample for at least 10 to 15 minutes before shutting your plasma down. This is best done with the plasma still on, and you will also be rinsing the spray chamber as well. This prevents salts in the spray chamber from depositing on your nebulizer after the instrument is shut down. If you actually need to clean a nebulizer, you must use an appropriate cleaning procedure specific for your particular nebulizer type. Please consult the manufacturer of your nebulizer. Some of these procedures are quite detailed, such as the one shown on the bottom left of this slide. This is the procedure for unplugging a glass Meinhardt nebulizer. I have included on this slide links to all the common manufacturer sites so that you can see what their procedures are. Another key thing to remember is to never sonicate a glass or quartz nebulizer unless you want to be buying a new one, because sonicating these types of nebulizers will actually destroy them. You can also use a backflush device such as the one shown on the bottom right of this slide. Just make sure that it is appropriate for your type of nebulizer. And finally, you can soak the nebulizer in a special cleaning solution, such as RBS25, which is recommended by some nebulizer manufacturers, and their detailed procedures for cleaning a nebulizer tells you how to use this particular solution. So now that we've talked about the role of the nebulizer, we need to talk about the final major component of the sample introduction system, or the spray chamber. The spray chamber plays a large role in conditioning the aerosol produced by the nebulizer. The spray chamber generally removes larger droplets greater than 20 microns and reduces the aerosol concentration so that you don't overload the plasma and cool it. Too much aerosol will cool the plasma and increase your matrix interferences. The spray chamber also reduces the turbulence of the nebulization process and smooths out small pulsations from the peristaltic pump. You should never see the aerosol in the spray chamber pulse. This will lead to high RSDs and indicates that you have a problem with the nebulizer or the pump tubing. A new option is available on some spray chambers, and this is called AMS, or the all matrix solution. In an AMS spray chamber, a small arm on the neck of the spray chamber called a matrix gas port, is used to introduce a small argon flow which dilutes the aerosol and can improve some matrix effects. We will talk about this in more detail later. A major part of aerosol conditioning is desolvation, which begins in the spray chamber. More desolvation in the spray chamber means a hotter, more stable plasma with more energy available for ionization. Desolvation can be improved by running at lower sample uptake rates, less than 250 microliters per minute typically, and/or cooling the spray chamber. The PC3X Peltier cooler is available as an accessory on the Nexeon ICP-MS systems. This unit is completely computer controlled and user programmable to either cool or heat the spray chamber from minus 10 to 80 degrees centigrade. Providing thermal stabilization of the spray chamber can also improve long-term stability and reduce oxides, which are a major source of interferences in ICP-MS. Cooling the spray chamber can also allow you to run at higher nebulizer gas flows, improving sensitivity while maintaining low oxide levels. If your ICP-MS system didn't come with a Peltier cooler for the spray chamber, this is something you can easily add to improve your performance. Another critical factor in your method development is to determine appropriate sample uptake, read delay, and washout times. These are critical parameters and will vary depending on the various components of your sample introduction system. It is critical to get this right. Most labs will speed up the pump during sample uptake to get the sample to the plasma faster and decrease overall sample-to-sample run times. When optimizing your uptake and read delay times, it is important to allow enough stabilization time, or read delay time, after the pump goes back to the speed used for data acquisition for things to stabilize. If you do not optimize these times correctly, you will see poor precision for replicates. Most labs use 3 replicates per sample. And as a ballpark figure, poor precision is greater than 10% RSD on a sample where you have a decent level of signal. We will talk more about precision as we go through this presentation. In general, running only one replicate in an analysis is never a good idea. Most laboratories will make multiple readings or replicates while the sample probe is in the same sample. The precision or relative standard deviation of these replicate measurements is an extremely valuable troubleshooting tool. Typical precisions as RSDs for good signal levels where you have several thousand counts per second of signal are generally less than 2 to 3%. Poor precision can indicate a variety of problems, including worn pump tubing, improper tension on pump tubing, and sample of uptake and read delay times that are incorrectly set. Multiple replicates is also good science by providing internal confirmation that the result obtained is repeatable. And only doing one replicate is bad science, where you're spending 95% of your time getting the sample to the plasma and only less than 5% of the time making your measurements. In the example on the upper right of the slide, if we look at our 3 replicates, we see that our count rates are increasing for each replicate. This is generally an indication that the sample uptake or read delay times are too short and that the sample is still getting to the plasma or taking longer to stabilize in the plasma due to matrix effects. In this next example, if we look at our replicates, the intensities of the replicates are decreasing with each replicate. This indicates that the previous sample may still be washing out. Check the concentrations of your previous sample and look at the washout times and the identity of the element to determine if you're having a washout issue. Let's talk a little bit about washout times. Carryover from the previous sample or standard is probably the number one most common cause of QC's failing and inaccurate results. You need to allow enough time for the nebulizer and the spray chamber to completely clear of the previous sample and to be reconditioned with the next sample before you start to make measurements. Be aware that some elements, like the ones listed below, are notoriously difficult to wash out and may require extended wash times, especially if you are calibrating to higher levels for these elements. The washout time will depend on the specific nebulizer, spray chamber, and the spray chamber temperature. You need to test this for your sample and your standards. Immediately recalibrating after your mid-level QC check fails is one of the biggest problems I see in customer data. If anything changes with your sample introduction system, you should repeat the washout study and check your washout times. One way to perform a washout study is to create a data-only method with your elements of interest. Put only one replicate in your method and have many readings per replicate, like in the example shown in the upper right. Start with the sample probe in your blank solution. Open the real-time display. Make note of the blank intensities for each element once the signal is stable. Manually aspirate your high standard or sample and watch the amount of time it takes for the sample to get to the spray chamber. This is your sample uptake time. For sample stabilization or read delay time, I generally recommend 20 to 30 seconds. This can be matrix dependent. For sample washout time, once the signal stabilizes, move the sample probe back to your rinse solution and time how long it takes for the signal to return to the original blank level. Another way to do a washout study is to use your regular method and run your blank and then your high standard or sample, and then analyze successive blanks until the blank signal returns to the original level. If it only takes one blank cycle, your washout times are probably okay. If there's still noticeable intensity in the first blank after the high standard or sample, then note how many blank cycles it takes to decrease the blank intensities to the original levels and increase your washout times accordingly. If you are running a FAST or a PrepFAST system, you will need to use the successive blank method so that the samples are all run through the valve timing cycle to check your washouts. This slide shows a summary of a variety of washout studies that I conducted when I worked at a geochemical lab for 100 ppb standard. The elements that are listed in pink are what are known as sticky elements, or elements that are difficult to wash out. On the far right-hand column, this sample introduction system is most like the sample introduction system used on the current Nexeon ICP-MS systems. And as you can see, for those sticky elements, the washout times are generally more than 7 minutes. You will need to conduct your own washout study for your particular ICP-MS system using the sample introduction system that you typically use. So in this next section, I want to switch over to talking about interferences in ICP-MS and troubleshooting method problems. In order to troubleshoot method problems that may be caused by interferences, you need to understand the processes that are occurring in the plasma. The first function of the high-temperature plasma is to remove the solvent or to desolvate the sample, leaving it as microscopic salt particles. Some of this process begins in the spray chamber and is greatly affected by the size of the aerosol droplets, which is why the nebulizer and spray chamber function we just discussed are so important. The next step is to vaporize the salt particles into a gas of individual molecules. These molecules are then dissociated into atoms. These processes occur predominantly in the preheating zone, or the lower part of the plasma. The plasma has one or possibly two functions remaining. These functions are excitation and ionization. These processes occur predominantly in the initial radiation zone and the normal analytical zone. The normal analytical zone is the region of the plasma where the analyte emission in ICP-OES is typically measured and where the ions are sampled by the sampler cone in ICP-MS. As I mentioned before, the plasma has a very short time, only about 12 milliseconds, given the speed of travel of the sample through the plasma to make all of these processes occur. So anything that would affect the rate or completeness of these processes can cause non-spectral or matrix interferences. So let's talk a little bit more about the non-spectral or matrix interferences in ICP-MS. These are interferences that cause a change in the signal intensity somehow, generally by the presence of concomitant elements or sample matrix elements also present in the sample that change the intensity of the analyte signal. This in turn changes the slope of the calibration curve or the response of an unknown sample measured against an established calibration curve. There are several well-known matrix effects that have been studied in ICPs since the 1970s. These include EIE, or easily ionizable element effects, aerosol ionic redistribution effects, organic enhancement effects, and matrix or acid washout effects. There are other matrix effects specific to ICP-MS, including space charge effects, which are a bit beyond the scope of today's talk. But know that the quadrupole ion deflector in your Nexian ICP-MS serves to minimize this type of interference to a large extent. The existence of these types of matrix effects are one of the reasons why the suggestion is often made to matrix match your calibration standards to your sample matrices as much as possible. This is the best way to get the most accurate results. However, knowing that they exist and what effects they can cause on your results will go a long way in helping you troubleshoot your method problems. The study of matrix effects in ICP-MS is a very complex subject, and we are still today understanding the chemistry and physics behind many of these. While I don't have time to go into a lot of details, this reference paper does an excellent job of reviewing these types of interferences and is a good place for you to begin to gain more of an understanding about these types of interferences. This next paper is another good reference paper on the subject of matrix effects. Although it was originally written for ICP OES, the exact same effects occur in ICP MS because most of these interferences occur in the nebulizer, spray chamber, and plasma, which are essentially the same in both techniques. It has also been long observed that the presence of organics in samples can cause signal enhancement of some analytes, of particular interest for those doing ICP-MS for arsenic and selenium. This paper discusses the causes and extent of those types of interferences. Probably the most commonly encountered matrix interference is that of the EIE, or easily ionizable element. EIEs are elements with very low first ionization potentials, and they are one of the most studied matrix interferences in both ICP-OES and ICP-MS. EIEs cause changes in the analytical signal because they modify the state of the analyte in the plasma. The plasma thermal characteristic, or the analyte excitation efficiency and spatial distribution in the plasma. In short, the presence of an EIE can change the slope of the calibration curve, leading to an incorrect result if your sample matrix differs significantly from that of your calibration. The most commonly encountered EIEs are lithium, sodium, potassium, and cesium. Their interference effect is generally proportional to their ionization potential. This version of the periodic table shows the first ionization potential for each element. The EIE elements are those elements listed on the far left of the periodic table. So the biggest problem is how to recognize that you have a matrix interferences such as an EIE effect. In ICP-MS, the biggest clue is when your internal standard or analyte intensities vary greatly for a particular sample, especially a sample that has a different matrix than your calibration standards. In this example, the calibration was performed with no matrix, all elements at 1 to 100 ppb in a 1% nitric acid solution. If you look at the first ICV, we see that the recoveries in just nitric acid are all fine. However, if we run an ICV solution where we have some matrix added, such as 25 ppm calcium and sodium and 5 ppm magnesium, potassium, and silicon, our ICV with the matrix actually fails. And we see that we have elevated recoveries for some elements. We have okay recoveries for a couple of elements. And the elements where we have acceptable recoveries are elements where we have high ionization potentials that are similar in ionization potential to the rhodium that was used as the internal standard for all of these elements. I generally include 2 to 3 alternate internal standards in my method and in my internal standard solution. The next test in troubleshooting to see if you have an EIE effect is to actually reprocess the exact same data with different internal standards. In these examples shown below, you can see that when I use germanium as the internal standard, almost all of the elements in the ICV that has the matrix added to it give acceptable recovery. However, silver does not. This is the original data from the previous slide with rhodium used as the internal standard, again showing that with the matrix added to my ICV solution, I don't get good recoveries for a lot of the elements. And the final set of data, using iridium as the internal standard, I get acceptable recoveries for the ICV with the matrix for a lot of the elements. However, there are several elements where my recoveries are actually low. This kind of reprocessing the same exact raw data using different internal standards is a good indication that you have an EIE effect if you see different results for different elements using a different internal standard. So one thing to keep in mind is that ICP-MS is a comparative technique. You have to calibrate the instrument response by running standards before you can run samples. The concentrations in the ICP-MS are calculated using the calibration curve, which is based upon the net intensity ratio of the analyte intensity divided by the internal standard intensity. For all this to work, the nebulizer and the spray chamber must control very precisely the mass of the analyte that reaches the plasma. Stability and reproducibility are critical. You need to have a steady state signal for successful multi-elemental analysis. Also keep in mind that more sample is not necessarily better. Too much sample, both matrix and solvent, can overload the plasma, cooling it, causing an increase in your matrix interferences. Most modern ICP-MS systems, such as the Nexion, are typically designed to run at sample uptake rates of less than 400 microliters per minute. The Nexion 1000 and 2000 systems should be run at less than 250 microliters per minute. And finally, keep in mind that probably 85% or more of significant interferences occur at the nebulization step. This is due to changes caused in surface tension, density, and viscosity by your sample matrix. This is why you must matrix match standards to samples as much as possible for the best accuracy. Matrix interferences are multiplicative interferences. That means they change the slope of the calibration curve. You also may need to match the ionization potential of your internal standards to your analytes to help compensate for matrix interferences. This is the equation that shows how the mean droplet size of an aerosol is calculated. The two things to remember is that the liquid density and the liquid viscosity, shown in pink, are two key factors which determine the mean droplet size. And please keep in mind that anything that changes the droplet size will change the amount of time that it takes for those aerosol droplets to become desolvated and ionized in the plasma. You don't have to remember this equation, but what you should just remember is there's a lot of chemistry and physics involved in aerosol dynamics. So some things to keep in mind as you are trying to troubleshoot your method problems. Matrix effects occur when the elemental composition in the sample matrix changes. This causes the size of the droplets to change and affects the ionization of the elements in the plasma. This in turn causes the slope of the calibration to change because the analyte or the internal standard signal, or both, changes. In ICP-OES, we have a rule of thumb that typically says you can start to see matrix effects when the total dissolved solids levels, or TDS levels, approach 1000 ppm. But they can also appear at lower concentrations than this. However, in ICP-MS, matrix effects can occur with even 50 to 100 ppm of total major cations, such as sodium, potassium, magnesium, and calcium. If you don't believe me, take a look at this calibration plot for zinc in standard mode. Standard mode means that there's no cell gas in the reaction collision cell. The blue points on this plot are a calibration up to 200 ppb with no matrix, just the analytes of interest, and you can see the slope of that line. The red dots are the calibration that was obtained when calcium, sodium, magnesium, and potassium and silicon are added at increasing levels to the top three standards. And you can see that the slope of this calibration line is 23% different than the slope of the calibration line without any matrix elements present. So basically, when 25 to 50 ppm of calcium or sodium and 5 to 10 ppm of magnesium, potassium, and silicon are added, the slope of the zinc calibration is suppressed by 23%. In addition, if you look at the information over on the right-hand side of this slide, the different internal standards are suppressed by different amounts. Rhodium is suppressed by 31%, iridium is suppressed by 6%, and germanium is suppressed by 16%. This means picking an internal standard that would try to compensate for this difference would be very difficult. It might be possible, but it won't fix everything. A similar effect occurs in KED mode. This is another zinc calibration plot where helium reaction gas was used. The blue points, again, are calibration up to 200 ppb with no matrix present, just the analytes of interest in a 1% nitric acid solution. The red dots are the calibration when matrix ions, calcium, sodium, magnesium, potassium, and silicon are again added to the top three standards. So again, when 25 to 50 ppm of calcium, sodium, and 5 to 10 ppm of magnesium, potassium, silicon are added, the slope of the zinc calibration is suppressed by 16%. And again, if you look at the information on the right-hand side of the slide, the internal standards are again suppressed by different amounts. 6.2% for germanium, and they're actually enhanced by 5% when scandium is used. So picking an internal standard could be critical and challenging in this particular case. So let's talk about EPA method 200.8 for a minute. A large number of ICP-MS users are running samples according to this method, or they use this method as a starting point because it is well known and well documented. How many of you are just calibrating for the trace elements and not including the major elements in your calibration standards? Because you aren't reporting these elements by ICP-MS typically. Generally, most labs report the major cations by ICP-OES. The problem is that every natural water has sodium, calcium, magnesium, and potassium present in significant, or ppm, levels. Sodium and potassium are EIEs. Calcium causes aerosol ionic redistribution effects, or it affects the speed of desolvation and vaporization of the droplets in the plasma. If you've had issues keeping your QCs or other check or known samples or standards in control that have levels of these major cations present, then you have some EIE effects occurring. This is some data I found on the concentrations of major cations in drinking waters around the U.S. I've grouped these according to general regions in the U.S. As you can see, the average concentrations are on the order of 20 to 30 ppm sodium and calcium, and 2 to 10 ppm potassium and magnesium. If you can estimate the average concentration of these major cations in the typical samples analyzed by your lab and build these levels into your calibration curves, you will see better results and less QC failures and less problems finding internal standards that work. So if you look at the calibration scheme we use in the drinking water application note for the Nexeon 2000, you can see that we are building an increasing level of the major cations in our calibration standards along with our traces. I have been doing this technique since I first developed turnkey methods for methods 200.8 and 6020 back in the late 1990s, and it really does work. We do this by making up a more concentrated matrix stock, let's say 5 times the highest target concentration for your major cation elements, and we spike in increasing levels of the major cations to each calibration standard. I generally don't add matrix to my lowest 1 or 2 standards to avoid contaminating them. So how does this work? So remember this data that I showed you just a few minutes ago using calibration standards with no matrix elements and different results for different internal standards on my check standards without matrix and with matrix present? And depending on the different internal standards that I used, we saw different results for the check sample that had the matrix added. If you use a calibration curve with increasing amounts of the major cations in each calibration standard, as I discussed in the previous couple slides, you see, if you look at this data, and these are the exact same solutions run, but I calibrated with increasing concentrations of the major cations in my top three standards. As you can see in this data, it doesn't matter which internal standard that I use. I get good or plus or minus 10% recoveries for all cases, whether the matrix is not present or if the matrix is present. So matrix matching your calibration to your actual samples in terms of the major cation concentrations will really help keep your quality control samples in control. So just a reminder about internal standards in ICP-MS. They are primarily used to compensate for changes in sample introduction uptake rates due to sample viscosity and tubing wear, as well as intensity changes due to changes in the interface cone orifices due to sample deposition over time. They might be able to be used to compensate for matrix interferences, but not always. And if the interference is an EIE effect, you will have to match the ionization potentials as well as compensate for other changes occurring due to the sample matrix, such as aerosol particle size and vaporization rates or completeness. This is nearly impossible to do for every element in a multi-elemental analysis where you have 20 to 30 elements present. There are too many competing effects all going on at the same time. There is also no perfect internal standard that will work for everything in every matrix all the time. The best way is to include alternate internal standards so that you can reprocess data with a different internal standard and see what happens. While we are on the subject of internal standards, let's talk briefly about how these are added. You can individually spike samples, but this can be time consuming and it can lead to errors if you are using small volumes, such as 50 microliters or less, and if you are not pipetting correctly. You can also potentially miss a sample or double spike a sample. This is human error and it happens. Most production laboratories use online mixing of the internal standards using a mixing tee or a valve of some sort. If you are using one of these devices, watch for air bubbles. These will cause signal fluctuations and erroneous results. You need to maintain or replace worn or contaminated mixing tees or valves. This does happen. They don't last forever. Also make sure that the sample flow rate and the internal standard flow are mixing correctly. You want to look for the RSDs on your internal standards. You should have fairly low RSDs, generally less than 2 to 3% if your internal standard is mixing correctly. If the RSDs are higher, you should suspect that things are not mixing or look for air bubbles. High RSDs in your internal standard will also cause more error in your results. You also need to be aware of the material used in your mixing tee and contamination. For example, some mixing tees are made of glass or quartz and can cause contamination for elements such as boron, sodium, silicon, calcium, and magnesium, as well as other elements if you are looking at low levels. Also, be aware of the dead volume of the mixing tee. This can cause sample carryover or contamination. In the old days, or the early days of ICP-MS, we used to use the mixing block shown in the middle picture. This mixing block is very bad. It has a very high dead volume and horrible sample washout. So I would recommend that you don't use that type of a device to mix your internal standards. Another thing to think about when you think you have a matrix interference problem is plasma loading. Keep in mind that more sample is not necessarily better. If you overload the plasma with too much sample or solvent, the plasma will be cooler and have less energy to overcome the matrix effects. Also, putting too much sample in can change the droplet size distribution produced. Since each nebulizer has an optimal sample uptake rate, you need to pay attention to this. Too high of a sample flow can cause larger aerosol droplets and therefore take longer to desolvate and eventually ionize. This will increase your matrix interferences. It is actually better to starve the nebulizer in most cases and run less sample flow to it. This leads to smaller droplets, which are much easier to desolvate. Remember, based on the nebulizer gas flow and distance between the tip of the injector to the sample cone, you have about 12 milliseconds or less to desolvate, vaporize, atomize, and ionize the elements in your sample. One thing that is often done to reduce matrix effects is to run at robust conditions. This gives a hotter plasma. This is typically achieved by increasing the RF power, decreasing your sample uptake rate, and moving the torch away from the interface 1 to 2 millimeters. This slows things down and allows the plasma more time to deal with the matrix interferences. Another way to reduce matrix effects is to use gas dilution. In the Nexeon ICP-MS, this is called AMS, or the All Matrix Solution. This is a special spray chamber with a gas addition port on the neck of the spray chamber and a mass flow controller and gas line to add a small flow of argon to the neck of the spray chamber, which dilutes the aerosol before it gets to the injector. This leads to more efficient ionization, fewer matrix effects, and less deposition on the sample cones, and less drift over time. AMS can also be used to attenuate the signal for all elements because it is essentially diluting the aerosol stream. The dilution level is variable and user-selectable, giving a predictable response across the mass range. It will also improve long-term stability, as this chart shows, which are spikes in an undiluted seawater matrix where AMS is used to increase the stability of the measurements over time. In the earlier work where I showed the matrix effects on the check standard recoveries and calibration curve suppression, the use of AMS can also improve the stability of the internal standards and improve overall long-term stability. The plot on the left-hand side of this slide showing the internal standard drift over the course of the run, in particular for rhodium, which is shown in green, is without the use of AMS. The plot on the right shows the same analytical sequence when AMS is used. AMS results in less overall drift in the internal standards, and the QCs remain stable for a longer period of time. Finally, let's look at one more accessory that can improve the long-term stability and performance of your ICP-MS, and that is an argon humidifier. What this device does is add water vapor or humidifies the nebulizer argon. The nebulizer argon flows through a water-permeable membrane inside a water reservoir. This prevents partial clogging of the nebulizer over time by the sample constituents from depositing in the nebulizer, especially samples with higher levels of aluminum, calcium, and magnesium, by allowing water microdroplets to continuously wash the tip of the nebulizer as the sample flows through it, as is shown by the photograph on the right-hand side of the slide. However, the proof is in the data. This is a plot of the internal standard drift over a 4.5-hour run using method 200.8 for drinking water using a standard Meinhardt nebulizer. The samples being run are USGS standard reference water samples, or typical environmental water samples, with varying amounts of total dissolved solids. As you can see, there is significant drift, up to 20% drift or more, over the 4.5 hours of this analytical run. Here, the run was repeated after the Pergo argon humidifier was installed. As you can see, the long-term drift of the internal standards over the 4.5 hours has pretty much been eliminated. The humidification of the nebulizer argon has eliminated the partial plugging of the nebulizer by the total dissolved solids in the samples. We have a new Pergo 2000, which is a less expensive, non-heated version of the original Pergo argon humidifier. It mounts directly onto the pump module of the Nexeon 1000-2000 ICP-MS and provides a clean installation, as is shown in the photograph on the right. It will connect directly to a Meinhardt or a PFA nebulizer. Alternate gas connections are available for use with other types of nebulizers, such as the Sea Spray or the Miramist. It is also compatible with FAST and PREPFAST systems and provides the same level of internal standard stability improvement. In addition, a two-channel version is also available to humidify the AMS gas. Basically, this is a must-have accessory for your ICP-MS that costs about as much as 1 to 2 nebulizers and will save you a lot of time by increasing the stability of your ICP-MS. It will also extend the lifetime and reduce maintenance on your nebulizers. After performing these studies, I'm now recommending that a Pergo be added to pretty much every ICP-MS system. Okay, our final section today is going to specifically talk about how to troubleshoot failing QC. Where do you start? Everything we've talked about today will give you new tools to help solve this problem on your own. First, you need to ask the question, is QC failing for all elements or just some? If all, the first step is to remake your standard or try a concentration closer to the midpoint of your calibration range. If just some, which ones? Look at the raw intensity data and look at the blanks and the calibration standards. If you read back your calibration standards as a sample, do they read back correctly? If not, you have a problem with the blank and or one or more of your standards. In other words, the problem is the calibration curve. If it's your second source failing, then you want to try making up the same level from your calibration stocks and see if that passes. If the answer is yes, then it's something with the two different standards. Look at all the elements present. Do you have an EIE interference or some other interference problem in one of the standard sources? If no, then look at your blanks and your calibration again, and also look at your washout. In general, if you can pass your daily performance check after optimizing the instrument or get close to it, and get a calibration curve for most or all of your elements, your QC failing does not mean the instrument is broken. It generally means that you have something wrong with the blank, the calibration curve, or some settings in your method. So we already talked about the fact that ICP-MS is a comparative technique. You have to calibrate the instrument using known concentrations prior to analysis of unknowns in order to determine accurate concentrations. This calibrates the intensity response of the instrument to known values. Other commonly asked questions about calibrations are how frequently and how many calibration points. Generally, calibration is done every day or before every different run for every different type of method that you're going to run. In terms of how many calibration points, that really depends on your analytical method. The most important part of a calibration, however, is the blank. If you look at this calibration plot on the left-hand side of the screen, the plot actually looks pretty good. However, if you zoom in and you look at the calibration blank for aluminum, we see that we have 11,000 counts for our blank on aluminum. This high count level for a calibration blank is ultimately going to determine how low we can actually see or calibrate aluminum to. So keep in mind, the blank is the most important point in your calibration curve. Why is the blank critical? If you have a bad blank, you have a bad calibration, and you're going to have bad data. All of your quantitative answers are going to be relative to your blank. Your contamination level determines your blank levels. Although contamination is always going to be present in your lab, it's important to minimize it to a level that is acceptable for your data quality goals. You need to examine the blank intensities every day at the beginning of the run and get familiar with typical values for your lab. You need to work on improving your blank levels and see those levels go down, and continue to monitor the blank daily after achieving good contamination control. Surprises happen all the time. This is some example ICP-MS data. In this data, the complaint was that the sodium, magnesium, and aluminum data was bad. If you look at where I have circled in red here, the check standard, which is supposed to be 20 parts per billion, is actually reading back at 21, 28, 17, and 16 parts per billion for the four analytes listed. If you actually go and look at, instead of the concentration data tab, and you look at the intensity data tab in the results display, you'll see the reason for these bad results. If you look at the blank levels, you see that beryllium has a nice low blank of only 21 counts. Sodium, magnesium, and aluminum, however, have very high blank levels, and your blank is actually contaminated, meaning that your low standards on your calibration curve, when you look at the upper plot here, are actually not reading that correctly. So your calibration is essentially being determined by your 100 ppb standard. And the other two standards are greatly affected by the contamination in both the blank and probably those standards. One thing to always keep in mind when troubleshooting is that you really need to look at the raw intensity data in order to troubleshoot a problem. So what do you look for when using raw data for troubleshooting? First of all, you want to look at the blank levels. You want to make sure that your blanks have low counts for all of the elements. You also want to look for linear relationships between the raw intensities. So if, for example, you look at the chromium column, we have a fairly linear relationship between the 10 and the 100, and also the 1 and the 10 once we take into account the blank. For vanadium and chromium, which have fairly good blanks, we have a linear relationship between the three standards that are circled in red. However, when we look at aluminum, we only have a linear relationship between the 10 and the 100, or the highest two standards in the calibration curve. If we look at the lower four standards and the blank, we see that we have a very high blank level, and that we do not have a linear relationship between the other four standards. This is an indication that we have contamination present in those standards as well as the blank. This is one of the reasons why your FAS will always ask you for your raw data files when they're helping you troubleshoot a potential method problem. When using raw data for troubleshooting, the other thing I look for is your replicate RSDs. Your replicate RSDs for non-blank samples should generally be less than 3%. High RSDs indicate a problem with your sample introduction, such as tubing tension or wear, a plug nebulizer, improper uptake times and read delays, or sample washout issues. So when you have a QC failed, one of the first instincts is to just immediately recalibrate, right? That's actually probably a big mistake. If you look at this recalibration data shown on the right, and you compare the calibration blanks from the first calibration to the second calibration, you'll see that the calibration blank is actually increasing. This is because the 100 ppb calibration standard that was run just prior to recalibrating has contaminated your system, and your calibration blank levels are actually increasing. This is going to make matters worse. What you really want to do is wash until your blank levels are stable, and then you want to recalibrate. If you're using a standard autosampler, you want to wash for 10 to 15 minutes before recalibration. If you're using a FAST or a PrepFAST system, you want to run 5 to 10 blank samples through the entire system to ensure the loops and the valve are clean before you recalibrate. This plot shows another typical problem. In this case, we have a calibration curve for 11 standards from 10 ppt to 1000 ppb with 6 orders of magnitude and an R-squared of 0.999, which is very good. However, the QC failed. Please remember that the correlation coefficient, or the R-squared value, tells you how well you can fit all the points onto a straight line. It doesn't tell you how far off each point is from that line. That would be determined by looking at the residuals, or the relative standard error of the calibration. On the previous slide, the R-squared was 0.999905, a great curve. But when you run a 0.1 ppb standard against that curve, it reads back as 4.002 ppb. There's a problem. How can this be if my calibration is that good? When you take a look at the same curve and go to the calibration plot view and zoom in on the lower part of the curve, this is what you see. The lowest 7 out of the 11 standards are all contaminated and are basically reading about the same level. So those lowest 7 standards are contributing nothing to your calibration curve, and the slope of your calibration curve is actually determined by your highest 4 standards. So to sum up the last section, please remember that seeing strange or unexpected results on certain elements isn't generally the result of an instrument or a mass spectrometer problem. Remember earlier I told you the detector is not element specific. If your instrument will pass the daily performance check and you can establish a calibration curve for most elements, having one or two elements not work right is generally the result of something that happened before the mass spectrometer or the detector. Primarily, you should look at interferences and contamination in blanks and standards. When trying to troubleshoot a problem, if your concentrations aren't reading back correctly, you need to go look at the raw intensity data, not the concentration data, to try and figure out the problem. Look at the blanks and the lower end of your calibration curve. Also look at your replicate RSDs. You could have something as simple as incorrect sample uptake, read delay, or wash times causing your problem. And the final thing to remember is that 95% of all the issues in ICP-MS occur in the sample introduction system. That means the pump tubing, the nebulizer, and the spray chamber. So when you are troubleshooting, you need to be observant. Stay and watch the run. Don't just queue up a recalibration and walk away. Look at the sample introduction system. Verify that all of your timings are correct and look at the blank and standard intensities and RSDs. Know your typical blank levels. Examine the raw intensity data for oddities. Calibrate sensibly for your samples. Go only as high as you need to, especially for hard to wash out elements such as silver and molybdenum. For issues with your QCs or known samples, look carefully at the blank and the calibration for clues. And finally, you must train yourself to look at the raw data. Just looking at the concentration result will not tell you anything. I hope this session will allow you to all start to troubleshoot your own data and method problems. And remember, if you want different results, you need to change something. And remember, when making changes, one thing at a time, or you will not figure out the true cause and effect. I want to thank you all for attending today's webinar on troubleshooting ICP-MS, and if you'd like to download today's presentation materials, you can do that by clicking on the Handouts tab and selecting the items available that you wish to download. I know that this was a fairly long session, but I hope you found it useful, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Hello all. Thanks for hanging in there. That presentation went a little long, but there's a lot of great information there. As a reminder, you can still submit questions through the questions pane in your attendee control panel. All right, let's Ruth, are you you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Okay, great, great. So just gonna look at some of these questions here. All right, so, oh, sorry, my questions pane disappeared on me. All right, here we go. We got quite a few came in. First question, what is the tolerable concentration of hydrofluoric acid for sample introduction systems or any other components that are not HF resistant?
That's a good question. I generally try to limit HF to less than 0.05% if I'm going to be running for any length of time. If you're running for a short period of time, you might be able to get away with 0.1%. Please keep in mind that if you have a glass nebulizer, spray chamber, or quartz, using dilute HF is actually one way to clean that system. So it will actually etch the interior surfaces that get wetted with the HF, and you'll see a lot of background from things that are present in quartz or glass, such as silica, aluminum, boron, for quite a long period of time. But you want to limit the time and the concentration to extremely low levels.
Okay, that's a good answer. Yeah, can't keep that HF low if you don't have HF resistant sample, especially nebulizer. The next question is, when operating an ICP-MS, it is common to optimize the nebulizer flow to run a method. Sometimes we have to optimize it daily. But is it recommended to keep changing the nebulizer flow daily, even if you're reaching an optimum flow? And does this affect the consistency of your data? Big question, but I guess they're just asking, you know, is optimizing nebulizer flow daily what you're supposed to do, and does that affect consistency of data?
Yes, I would say you do want to optimize your nebulizer flow daily, because as you run samples, you will see, and one of the reasons why your internal standards start to drop off over time is you're partially clogging your nebulizer. And if you don't re-optimize the nebulizer, you'll start seeing your intensities drop off as well. So you may notice that, you know, if you have the same nebulizer in there for a week, you might notice that to get the same signal level, you have to increase the gas flow or the nebulizer gas slightly, a little bit more each day to get the same signal level. And that's an indication that your nebulizer is partially clogging. The Nexian software actually has a nebulizer back pressure readback if you go into the logbook. And that is one good thing to monitor and know what a new nebulizer of the type you're using, what its back pressure is. And then you can monitor that. And if you see the back pressure going up and you see your nebulizer gas flow increasing over time, you know that you're partially clogging your nebulizer, and you probably either need to do maintenance or replace it.
That's really good reason to do it, so you can monitor its performance. Good point. Yep. Next question: what is the optimum volume of digested sample solution to get a good signal?
That really depends on how low you need to see in terms of detection limits, what your sample matrix is, what the elements are. So there's no good one answer.
That's so many variables, right? There depends on the sample type, acids, detection limit requirements. We'd have to look at a case-to-case basis. So
yeah,
that's a tricky one to answer just generally. I'm just reading through the questions here. I find that we had one question. Are different lamps needed for the analysis of different elements like AA?
The answer to that question is yes. We don't need lamps in ICP-MS, which is what today's talk was about. But if you are doing analysis by AA, you need to use a lamp for the element that you're trying to determine, or a multi-element lamp that contains the element that you're
but not for ICP techniques, right? Because they're producing right. ions and atoms that we then quantify. It's definitely different than AA in that regard. This is just a comment. This is a good one. The best presentation I've seen in a long, long time. Fundamental issues were explained very clearly. Once available, I'll make this presentation a requirement for all the staff here. Well, that's a good one, Ruth.
Thank you.
Is the presentation recorded? Yes, all these webinars, atomic spectroscopy seminars that we're putting on, the whole series, are all recorded. And they will be a link to them will be posted to the website, the page there. I'll show you the link soon here. And also those who registered will get a link to the recording in about 24 hours.
Yeah. The other thing is in the handout section, the slides that were used along with the speaker notes are up available for download as a PDF. So if you'd like a copy of the presentation, please go in and download it before you leave today.
Yeah, that's a good point, Ruth. Yeah. So in the handout section, you'll see if you click here or here, you'll see handouts and you can download all the various handouts that that Ruth uploaded for this webinar. So it's a good point. Maybe a couple more questions here. Look, I got quite a few there. What could be the problem if I notice that the intensity is going down in the calibration curve in DRC mode? It's an interesting one. I've never seen that.
A couple of the most common reasons for negative slope calibrations is your calibration blank is contaminated. So take a look at your raw intensity counts on your calibration blank and your standards. Another common thing is mixing up your standards, putting them in the internals in the auto sampler in the wrong order. I've done that myself several times. But the biggest thing is to see if your blank is actually contaminated. And if the contamination in the blank is higher than, let's say, your first two or three standards, you're going to get really strange and probably negative answers for those calibration standards.
Good point. And I think maybe one more question here. When looking at inconsistent data, at what point should you look at the cones?
I generally optimize the torch position, the nebulizer gas flow on the Nexian, the QID first. The cones is if you see a overall decrease in sensitivity for all elements that any of those first three optimizations don't appear to get rid of, or if you look at your cones visually and you see a lot of buildup. I've seen cones that look like, you know, they have snow on the top of a mountain. There's so much deposit on the cone. So if you see a lot of generally white, or sometimes if your samples have high carbon in them, black deposits on the cones, then you might want to consider also cleaning your cones. But if you see visible deposits that are making the orifice in the cones smaller, then you're going to see sensitivity decreases and you should do cone maintenance.
Yeah, good point. And then I always get this question on the frequency. What should be the frequency of the cleaning the sample introduction or maintaining the sample introduction?
That really depends on. Yeah, it's very variable. It depends on the samples that you run. It also depends on the care that you take after your last sample of the day. I find I have to do less maintenance if I, you know, generally wash everything out for, I usually wash everything for half an hour with my clean acid blank after my last sample, take the internal standard probe out, wash that line out, make sure that the only thing that's left in the nebulizer and spray chamber is your nice clean, 1%, 2% nitric acid solution. If you run really high TDS samples, you're pushing the limits, you're trying to run the 0.2% TDS all the time, you're going to have to do more maintenance on your nebulizer and also your cones. So you're going to get more deposit on your cones. So,
yeah. Okay, well, I think there's quite a few other questions, but we're about almost an hour and a half now, so I think we'll end that. And you know, feel free to reach out to Ruth or I or your local application scientist if you have any additional questions. Note, if you're running ICP OES or have interest in troubleshooting OES, Ruth continues this series next week, next same time, same place. For part two, for making the most of your ICP OES. And if you're interested in any other webinars, all the other webinars in this series, you can visit this page. You'll get a link to sent to you in your email. And thank you, Ruth, and thank you everyone for attending today's webinar. If you have any other questions, please contact Ruth or myself. You'll have my email address in the registration letter. And once you leave today's webinar, you may have a survey. So please, you know, answer that, reply to that, and have yourself a great day. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.